on ESPN Classic. Get ESPN Classic. Call your cable or satellite provider now.
The Stanley Cup, the oldest trophy competed for by professional athletes in North America. Lord Stanley purchased the thing for $50. It has been competed for only by NHL teams since 1926.
Yeah, but John, the Canadian dollar is worth more then.
That's right. Night two of the Stanley Cup playoffs, and here to bring it to you, Ray Ferraro, Barry Melrose, and I am John Butcher. Guys, I just had a feeling coming into this postseason it was going to be a very special one. And boy, are we off to a good start.
What a playoff so far. Unbelievable year.
I can't believe John is he picked his Ducks here, and you know, and they
in a row.
Give Red Wings as hard as they can tonight.
Hate me in Detroit. They are defending champs and essentially the same team they were last year, minus Hall of Famers at very key positions, the goaltender and the coach. The goaltender, Dominik Hasek, is back in the Czech Republic and perhaps will stay up late and watch game one of the Wings and Ducks. The coach, Scotty Bowman, he will be at Joe Louis Arena. Bowman says, quote, Ken Holland asked me to come. I'll be another set of eyes. That's all. And Barry, all eyes on you and your keys to the Red Wing Ducks series.
Well, again, going into this series, a couple things had to happen. And the first one is Cujo, the goaltender for Detroit. This guy's got so much pressure on him. He's got to play great. The Ducks will start with scoring. Can they score enough against the mighty Detroit Red Wings? Power play. They got to find a way to create offensive power plays, the way to do it. And Jaguar's been their best player all year long. Will he be the best player in the playoffs? The key again, Joseph. He came here to replace Dominik Hasek, who won a Stanley Cup. Can he do the same thing for Detroit Red Wings?
Cujo, and a triple. That's a major focus. And look at this.
Oh, that smells good. That stinks from here.
You know, it's the playoffs. First period, Detroit power play. Shanny genuflects and scores his 51st career playoff goal. Wings off to a great start, 1-0. Later in the first, Sauer point shot. Look at 77. Tie the game at 1-1. Meanwhile, J.S. Chiguer, first postseason appearance. But in overtime, boy, you wouldn't believe it. And early on, Ray, you had a sense nothing was getting by him.
I said early in this overtime, he looks like he's just going to stop pucks all night. He got lucky a couple of times, but he was so steady in the net. He never seemed to get flustered. Mike Babcock thrilled that he's in goal form.
Midway through the overtime, Luke Robitaille, score! The red light comes on. The crowd goes wild. The players hug. There's the light. Whoa, but Jaguar, they call him Jiggy, is getting jiggy with it. He says no goal. There's a TV right on the Red Wing bench, and they saw right away that, Ray, it didn't go in.
Yeah, crossbar goal post that comes out. The correct call made by the replay. The Ducks catch a break. Luke takes a drink of water and hopes for one more chance.
Just over a minute later, not a replay. Look at this. The puck's on top of the net. The Ducks, as underdogs, you need breaks. They're getting breaks. Look at Sandis Ozolinch take a penalty on Henrik Zetterberg. Holding. Ensuing power play. We know how good this power play is. Lariatov to win. Barry.
Early,
I missed this one.
Early in overtime, I said the next goal wins. Right here, Lariatov comes off the far wall. Jaguar makes an unbelievable glove save as he did all night long for the Ducks, all season long for the Ducks.
Smack off the face of Jiggy. Nicklas Lidström. Played over 40 minutes in this game.
He's just resting there. That's
he
just
was.
A blow time.
Give a wink to the trainer.
Yeah, the old wink.
Stumpy Thomas for the win. He shot it over the net. No one's better in overtime than Stumpy.
Yeah, he's got the big wedge on his stick. He can really take the slap shot there. He's not very happy.
He's feeling shame, baby. Yeah, he's feeling shame.
Not a very good shot there.
Maybe it's because he's wearing a purple helmet. Second overtime, dead in a wraparound, off the boot. That's how these things usually end.
You know it's your night, man, when those things start happening, hitting poles on top of the net, going in.
Third overtime, shot to the net, Paul Kariya, cha-cha-cha. What Bono is to you two, Paul Kariya is to the Mighty Ducks. He came into this game with one goal in his last 18 regular season games. This is the first triple overtime game to start any series since Edmonton beat Boston on Peter Klima's overtime goal in game one of the 1990 Cup Final. J.S. Chiguer, 63 saves, most by a goalie making his first playoff start since at least 76-77. Before then, record's a bit sketchy. But of course, the man of the hour, the man with the power, Paul Kariya, second career overtime goal.
You know, overtime was a struggle. They definitely outplayed us in overtime. Jiggy was unbelievable tonight. He made some huge saves out there, and we'll take the win.
He made some huge saves. Wow, what an understatement that is.
63 of them. Okay, so Paul Kariya-Barry, his 15th career playoff game, 9th career playoff goal. Let's go back to your keys and a refocus, please.
Well, I think it really turned out what I was talking about with these keys. Where was the scoring going to come from? It came from the right guys. You saw Oates get a goal. You saw Kariya get a goal. Two guys that have to score. The power play did not score.
Oh, for four.
I thought they really moved the puck around well, had some chances to score. And again, the goaltender got the job done. He was fantastic. Curtis Joseph played very well, certainly did not have the work, especially in overtime, that Jaguar did. But again, he's there to win the Stanley Cup. Nothing else will do for the Detroit Red Wings.
All right, so there it is. Game one goes to the Ducks, and they lead this best of seven, one game to love. You can call the Toronto Maple Leafs a lot of things, and a lot of people do. But you cannot call them lucky. Injuries once again have hit the Leafs, who won game one over Philly Wednesday night. Nick Antropov and Darcy Tucker, the latest to get nicked. Darcy Tucker hyperextends his left knee on a check by Eric Weinrich. He is doubtful for game two Friday night. MRI revealed an injury that was less severe than originally thought. Nick Antropov, a long crack along the small bone in his foot. The injury is similar to the one that kept Phil Housley out for 7 weeks. Michael Renberg told me and Ray on ESPN Radio Thursday that Paul Healy and Alexei Ponikarovsky dressed and skated on Thursday. All right, one game down, three to go on night two of the Stanley Cup playoffs. All the sights and sounds when we come back, including Robert Lang and the Capitals breaking down the Boo Lin Wall in Tampa Bay. Game one there, and it was a wild night in Denver as the first-timers from Minnesota had the Avs back on their heels. NHL Tonight continues after this.
Introducing the 7-Up Parade Balloon. It's going to make people want the refreshing taste of 7-Up. And it's completely realistic. I even gave it a pull tab.
Introducing a new level of performance from Acura. The all-new TSX.
Darn it. Time out. Hey. Why are you shaking me off?
I want to bring the heat up to announce my presence with authority.
To announce your what?
To announce my presence with authority.
Announce your presence with authority? This guy's a first ball fastball hitter. He's looking for heat.
Oh, yeah? So what? He ain't seen my heat.
All right, mate. Give me a heat.
Baseball Tonight, all season long on ESPN and ESPN.
Turn a boring bathroom into something extraordinary during the spring sale at Menards. Save on a great selection of Pace vanities. This 24-inch ready-to-finish oak vanity is just $87.96. A 24-inch Kingsbury oak model is $99. Finish your bath project with a lifetime warranty faucet by Moen. The Valetta faucet in chrome is just $59. This stylish Hi-Arc model is $129. Get the best for your bath at Menards.
Save big money at Menards.
Spring is finally here, and there's never been a better time to test drive a 2003 Mazda 6. It's yours for just 3.9% financing. Fly behind the wheel of an all-new Mazda Protege sedan or sporty Miata and get 0% financing for 60 months. Or choose a Mazda Tribute, the SUV with the soul of a sports car, and get a $2,000 rebate and 4.99% financing. Get the Mazda you want and a 4-year, 50,000-mile bumper-to-bumper warranty at Mid-North Indiana's only Mazda Elite dealer, Bill Andrews Mazda, State Road 38 East in Lafayette.
Access the Stanley Cup Playoffs. Maple Leafs versus Flyers, immediately followed by Oilers versus Stars. Will you be watching?
Quote, maybe we can frustrate them, says the Wild's Andrew Brunette. We're a pain in the butt team to play against. Minnesota head coach Jacques Lemaire suggests the way to stop the vaunted Avalanche is to untie their skates. David versus Goliath. Minnesota against Colorado is Darren Pang against Yao Ming. 227 playoff games in which Wild players, 13 of them, have appeared. 1,608 postseason games in which 25 players on the Avalanche roster have appeared. Game one in Denver, I see on ESPN2, and Scott Parker with a message on his hockey stick. And Peter Forsberg and the Avs, their last 17 home games, 14-0-2-1. Dwayne Roloson with the start. First period, no score. Barry Roloson, a gamer.
Well, he's done it all year long, John. It shouldn't be a surprise. He's been as good as any goalie in the NHL. With the defense in front of him, he just has to make some key saves at key times, and we've seen it. We shouldn't be shocked. Pat, again, he's done it tonight also.
Yeah, 18 key saves in the first period. Second period, still no score. Power play, Minnesota. Andrew Brunette. Boy, you played with him, right? He sees the ice pretty well, huh?
He's got great hands from below the goal line. Brunette takes the puck, sees Kuba coming in from the backside, feathers a perfect pass.
And look at that record when the Wild score first. Best in the league. Later second, same score. Parker in front, dicey call on Brad Brown. Penalty is called. Cliff Ronning, point shot. And look at this one, in the feet of Gabrick. But of course, skilled players can still get a lot on their shot when it's in their feet. 2-0 Wild. Dupuis, Wes Walls. Ray, what in the wide world of sports is going on here?
Colorado lost their head for a couple of seconds here. Skula gets bumped off the puck by Marshall. Dupuis takes it around the back of the net. Rob Blake gets caught standing in front of the net, not taking anybody. The puck goes over and it's put in the net. It's 3-0. Unbelievably.
Yeah, 3 goals in 4 minutes, 20 seconds. We talk about great players with pucks in their feet. Look how much Sackett gets on it. Joey is clutch and clutches everything. 66th career playoff goal. Patrick getting bored. No, boy. Andrew Brunette will get credit for that goal. Minnesota, how about the Wild? The Golden Gophers are winners. The Wild are winners. Kuba, Gabrick, Walls, Brunette, 39 saves for Roloson in the end. Colorado has lost 3 straight playoff games going back to the Detroit series last year, and they've dropped their 3rd straight series opener. Patrick Roy, historically not very good in game ones. He gets better. Joe Sakic, 10th postseason for Joe. Ray Ferraro, and he's always good except for a couple of years ago when he had just had 2 goals in 17 games. Not a lot of great line mates to play with right now. It's going to be tough for him to provide some offense.
Well, the challenge for Joe Sakic is going to be getting some goals and creating chances with the guys that he's playing with. Tony Granato doesn't have a lot of options because Hajduk, Forsberg, and Tanguay are one line. He's got him with Steven Reinprecht and Bates Battaglia, and Sakic makes a lot on his own. You see him take the puck hard to the net here. Battaglia takes it, tries to wrap around, which Roloson makes the save. Rob Blake with the shot. Sakic has a glorious chance. It hits the defenseman's stick instead of going into the net. Here's Sakic with his great wrist shot, hits Roloson in the head. Tony Granato's told me that Sakic's played very well down the stretch, just didn't have any puck luck around the front of the net. There's another great chance that he shot the puck wide. I thought Joe was their best player tonight. He had a lot of jump in his stride. Here we see the goal again. He takes it off his front foot. Tough one-timer from Reinprecht, and he puts it in the net. If Colorado is going to win in this series, they're going to have contributions from many different players. They have the top-scoring defense in the league. Forsberg's line will get their goals. Joe Sakic is going to have to create a lot on his own. Towards the end of the game, as they were down a couple of goals, Granato put him on the line with Forsberg and Hajduk, try to generate even more offense. That's something you may see from time to time in the series.
All right, game two, ABC on Saturday. Well, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Caps in Tampa Bay. Game one. Tommy Yager, first playoff game as a Capital, Barry.
Well, who'd have thought that would happen? But yeah. He had a good year. He played well at the end of the year. And on the other side of the coin, is that kid going to future at him?
First period, no score. Lightning dump. Puck comes off the boards right to Chris Dingman. Oh, only a big save in the first period. Keeps it scoreless. Now, later in the first, Mike Greer. Puck goes up in the air, and Robert Lang. Hand-eye coordination, Barry Melrose.
But the key to the play is that Robert Lang knows enough that he can't put a stick above the crossbar. The goal would not count. He keeps it down low. Great hand-eye coordination. Probably hit 400 in the Major League Baseball.
Looked like your fast-pitch softball days back in Kelvington.
Well, mine went a lot farther than that.
1-0, early second, and Ole. Deflects it wide.
You don't hit him far, you got to run.
On the Brad Richards wrist shot. Later second, 1-0 Caps. Here comes Prospel to Vinny, and what a move! But look at that extension from Ole, the goalie. Give me 2 replays, Chicken Parm.
Yeah, Prospel, who's had a terrific year for the Lightning, makes a nice feed over to Le Cavalier to allow him to take it to the net. And look at Kolzik Big guy able to get his leg back, makes a great save.
Turnover in the neutral zone, and I love right-handed shots on the off wing when they stick it high, Barry.
Well, I think Happy Boone was cheating on the pass here. Lang is notorious for shooting or for passing more than he shoots. Great turnover here, transition game. Washington's much better defensively than people give him credit for, and they shut the door after they scored this goal. Robert Lang, pretty good pickup in the summer.
All right, early third period, some really good passing here. Gonchar, tragically Kit Miller, right to Michael Nylander. His first career playoff goal in his 19th playoff game, and all he does at the Caps. They've won four of their last five series openers. The Lightning shut out for the first time in their brief playoff history, seven games. They were shut out just twice during the regular season. They were 0-4 on the power play, and they were 2-32 on the power play against Washington during the regular season after scoring no goals in his first 18 career playoff games. Robert Lang, 9 in his last 28. Only 6 of the 9 playoff shutouts in the 29-year history of the Washington Capitals. The Bolts were shut out again just twice during the regular season, and there's Vinny LeCavalier. 6 shots in 21 minutes of ice time. Well, Barry, you watched this game, you focused on it. What did you see? What were the keys?
Well, the two things I've been selling in this series, that I feel Kolzig is as good a goaltender as Happy Boole, and I don't know if many people feel that way, but I certainly do. And Kolzig's been to the Stanley Cup Finals before, so he's got some experience. And the Washington Capitals just have too much offensive talent up front. Now, the goaltending was great. The guys were getting the right chances for Tampa Bay. LeCavalier, Richards, Prosper, but he made saves. And these are at key times in the game, folks. This is when the game's on the line. That's what I like about a great goaltender like Kolzig. Now, the offensive talent of Washington, look at that play by Jágr. You're going to see great puck movement here. Nylander's got great speed right there. Good movement also. Jágr's got the puck again. He did not score a goal tonight, but he was very effective. I thought he played very well. He didn't get the goal there, but it was great passing. So you saw the offensive ability of Washington. When you make a mistake against Washington, it ends up on someone's stick that can score. Not many teams have that ability. And again, the goaltender, key saves at key times. They're going to be a tough team to beat, John, and they're starting to believe in themselves again.
He's a Conn Smythe winner, only the goalie.
He's been there before.
Yeah, game two, ABC, Saturday. While you wonder if in the future NHL teams will put in players' contracts, no conceiving children in June, July, or August. Otherwise, you could be tempting playoff fate. Pavel Demitra returned to St. Louis Wednesday morning for the birth of his first child, a moment for those who have experienced it cannot be topped. The problem is the Blues are in Vancouver. However, Demitra made it back for game one. The question is whether jet lag will affect Pav Henry. Of course, congrats to Pav Henry Jr. Game one in Vancouver. Is that man healthy, Dan Cloutier?
I don't think he's 100%. I don't think anyone thinks he's 100%. I'm not sure Drake's going to be 100% after that hit.
That's a penalty. An ensuing power play. Doug Waite's shot redirected by Corey Stillman. Chicken Parm, you played with both those guys last postseason.
Yeah, Doug Waite's played the power play almost exclusively on the point this year. He has a nice shot. Stillman had a great rebound year for the Blues this year. He tips it by Kluche. Bad penalty by Bertuzzi early in the game. The Blues are up.
31 seconds later, Sean Podine.
Playmaker to Tyson Nash.
Well, he gives it to the right guy. Sean knows the most dangerous player on that line. Two chances for Tyson Nash. That's going to hurt you every time. Tyson Nash is nice to see the tough guys get rewarded. That's a checking line. They're not going to get a lot of offense out of those guys, but right there they do.
Best head of hair in hockey, Mark Crawford calls a timeout. Later first, Canuck pressure, and Chris Osgood.
They'll be tearing some of that out if things don't get better.
Joel Quenneville and his boys looking good. 2-0. Early second. Power play just ending. They move it. Good movement. Demitra.
Oh.
Kachuk, Walt with no lid. That head's too big. How does it stay on ever?
Well, what an obstacle on the ice if that helmet's rolling around. But Demitra and Kachuk make a nice give and go. Walt puts it away. Blues are up 3-0. This is a very shaky, confidence-wise Vancouver Canucks team.
Yeah. Henrik Sedin ran into that helmet and he's out.
He may be in the middle of that helmet and he can't get out of it.
First three goals all score within 2 minutes of the first period or the second period. More to come here on NHL Tonight. Ed Belfour, 28 saves in game one against the Flyers. But Bubba tells us why that may not be good enough to win a series. But first, Robert Lang scored twice in the Caps 3-0 win. But we want to know who was the last Capital to get a hat trick in the playoffs. Barry got his right on night number one. Ray got his wrong. Dino, Drews, Gartner, or Big Al? The answer next.
ESPN HD. Sponsored by Phillips and Best Buy.
All right. Awesome start. You're looking great out there.
We need 20. We need a damn job, okay?
Dude, awesome saves out there.
Guys, first period starts in 5.
to the end of our losing streak.
Going fishing?
Yeah, in the basement.
That's it. I've got to do something about this water seepage.
Tired of living with a drab, wet basement? You don't have to with Drylock Masonry Waterproofer. Drylock penetrates the pores and expands as it dries to form a tough, waterproof barrier.
I can't believe this is your basement. Drylock really got rid of your water problem.
Yeah, now if we could just get rid of that fish.
Drylock, it's guaranteed to stop water.
You rely on shampoos to care for your hair. But what about dandruff? Head & Shoulders Anti-Dandruff Shampoo. The only shampoo with micro-ZPT. It works directly on your scalp to help stop dandruff where it starts. So your scalp is flake-free. And your hair looks and feels beautiful. Head & Shoulders Shampoo. For hair that is beautiful and flake-free.
We know you do it. You comparison shop. You come to Travelocity, you check out a fare, and then you run off and see if you can find it lower. But it's okay. We don't mind. You'll be back. Why? Because Travelocity consistently has the most low fares, making Travelocity the final destination for comparison shoppers everywhere.
You'll also find the most discounted hotels. Book your hotel for summer travel now and save.
Travelocity. Call or Seaside for details.
Later on SportsCenter, the Lakers, the Kings go toe-to-toe in Hollywood while the Dodgers and Giants get busy by the Bay. Plus, the Wings start their drive to a second straight cup. Linda Cohn, John Anderson, SportsCenter, ESPN.
Access the Stanley Cup Playoffs. Versus Flyers, immediately followed by Oilers versus Stars. Will you be watching?
All right, what are your guesses, boys? Barry?
I think John Drews.
You're absolutely wrong. It's Al Iafrati. You want to know why he knows, Barry?
No.
He played in the darn game, and he got 4 goals himself. Yeah, good try, Al. You got 3. I got 4.
Chicken. You didn't make the question.
No, chicken. <All right. laughs> Devils center Scott Gomez intends to play against the Boston Bruins on Friday, despite spending part of the playoff opener in the hospital being tested for a possible concussion. Gomez didn't skate with the team Thursday, but he did ride a bike in the locker room. Apparently felt well enough afterwards that he will be a go. All right, let's talk about Toronto and Philly now. Ray and I talked with Michael Remberg on ESPN Radio. He said he skated on a line with Matt Sundin and Gary Roberts in practice, and that game two is Friday night, Barry. And Toronto, a good game one. Should they feel comfortable?
No, they shouldn't feel comfortable because they were outplayed by Philadelphia. Okay. Not totally outplayed. Yeah. It's not like Belfour stole the game for him. Eddie didn't have to be unbelievable. But I think that's going to have to change as the series goes on. I think the strength of Toronto is the goaltending over Philadelphia Flyers' Roman Čechmánek. Eddie was better than Roman in game one, and they won the game. But I think some other guys for the Toronto Maple Leafs must start playing better. They didn't get the job done. Great, great players should dominate come playoff time. And that is Owen Nolan and Gary Roberts, two guys that are physical powerhouses, guys that can really dominate. Oh, there's my tape. It's a little late, but it's coming now. Eddie Belfour is a great goaltender. This guy has won a Stanley Cup. He's been to the finals 3 times. One of the reasons Toronto got him was to take a run at the Stanley Cup. I thought he was good in game one. I didn't think he was unbelievable in game one. I didn't think he had to be. Now we talk about Nolan and Roberts. These are two powerhouse forwards. I thought Roberts was the best player on the ice last year for the Toronto Maple Leafs. This year wasn't the case in game one. I thought they were both pretty invisible. Nolan is a physical presence. He's tough. He can score. He's nasty to play against. He must really pick it up against those big Philadelphia defensemen. Roberts is a guy that has scored goals, guys that plays a tough defensive game, very similar to Nolan, except plays the other side of the rink. So those two guys must pick it up for the Toronto Maple Leafs if this team is going to beat the Philadelphia Flyers. Philly is deeper. They got more offensive weapons. That must change. Here's Roberts coming back, picking up Primo. Good defensive work. But his job is to score goals. They got lots of guys that can check. They don't have many guys that can score consistently like Gary Roberts. He goes to the net hard. He's a physical force in front of the net. So if those two guys get better, I thought Sundin was very good in game one. I thought McGillney was very good in game one. The defense for Toronto was pretty good. It'll get better. So those three guys are keys for any Toronto success down the road.
Game two is Friday night on ESPN2 right here. Meanwhile, the Edmonton-Dallas series, again, another surprise. It's been a playoff of upsets thus far. Mike Bonanno, Daryl Sador, know how competitive the Dallas-Edmonton matchup has been. They are the only two players to appear in all 28 postseason contests between the two clubs since the spring of 97. 20 of the 28 games have been decided by one goal, including eight of the last nine. Game two is Friday night, and we're very excited that Ray Ferraro will make his analyst debut during that game with Dave Strader. Any tips for Ray?
Yeah, don't talk when the goal goes in. If you're talking when the goal goes in, you're the guy that screwed up.
Well, I'm hoping Dave's got his A game.
Speaking of talking, you talked with Tommy Salo today, the Edmonton goaltender. What did he tell you?
A couple of interesting things, actually. When Salo was talking about how they played in game one, he talked about how calm they were and how they would just continue to try and play four lines against the Dallas Stars, how they used their full allotment of players that allowed them not to get tired as the game went on. He also mentioned that it was a lot quieter in the building in the new American Airlines Arena than the last time they played Dallas in the playoffs in New old Raucous Arena over at Reunion Square, where it's a great small building. This is a big building. They felt much more comfortable in the game. Salo also mentioned that coming into this series, he got to rest a little bit down the stretch. In the past, he's played up to 70 games a year. This year, he didn't play as many, and he didn't play as many late. They had a lot of faith in Markkanen. He feels he's much more rested coming into the playoffs and feels he can be at his top of his game.
A fresh Swede is an effective Swede.
And I think the ice in the new building is a little bit better than Reunion, which will help the skating Edmonton Oilers.
So. Good point. All right, more to come here on the NHL tonight. Tonight's three, which is on the way, salutes overtime cup-winning goals on a very special anniversary. A special tonight's three is on the way.
Out new Close Shave Barbasol Gel.
Close.
Goodbye irritation.
Who's next?
Love Close, hate irritation? Better buy new Barbasol Gel.
The backyard has a fence. The playground has a fence. The ball field has a fence. Beyond the fences, new worlds are waiting. Go on. Pursue your passions. Go RVing. Call for a free video and visit an RV dealer.
Michelin designed the cross-terrain SUV tires specifically for SUVs to help provide responsive handling and a smooth ride. You'd be surprised just how smooth. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
The players.
Way back there.
The experts.
His track record is pretty solid.
The definitive source for everything baseball. Catch all the scores and highlights from around the league. Baseball Tonight, all season long on ESPN and ESPN2.
A guy in the corner, big producer. What's his name?
I don't know.
You sure it's not written there? Call my agent in New York.
Life's good when you're Eric McCormick.
Hey, it's me. I mean, LA. The producer we had that meeting with last week. What's his name?
It's Max Hoffman.
Max Hoffman. Thank you very much.
But life's better when you're Eric McCormick and you have the cell phone with a walkie-talkie. Coast-to-coast walkie-talkie service coming soon. Only from Nextel.
We're taking NHL tonight to 12:30 Eastern time. Stick around. Plenty of hockey talk to come. An update in Vancouver. Havanoff makes it 4-0. Canucks can't get a shot on goal, Ray.
Each shot is terrible through a period and a half. St. Louis plays a very aggressive style, but the Canucks have to mount some offense. I mean, they had four power plays, and they still only have eight shots.
So the Blues off to a great start in game one against the Canucks. While the sale of the bankrupt Buffalo Sabres to Thomas Golisano has been approved by a U.S. bankruptcy court judge and the NHL's Board of Governors, NHL Commissioner Gary Bettman says the $92 million deal is expected to close within 10 days. Sabre lawyer William Thomas says the team, whose season ended Sunday, is close to running out of its court-approved $25 million financing. Well, Islander forward Eric Goddard was suspended for one game by the NHL for this high-sticking incident. But Ottawa's Chris Neal, he will miss game two of the first round series with Ottawa on Saturday.
Well, what a game one it was between the Anaheim Mighty Ducks and Detroit Red Wings. A triple overtime classic won by the Ducks on Paul Kariya's goal. Kariya played 34 minutes and 41 seconds. He took 52 shifts, six shots on goal, the last one going in. After the game, Kariya talked with Gary Thorne and Bill Clement.
Well, a tremendous performance by the Mighty Ducks, who got so outplayed in the two overtimes. And the story of this is going to be, even though Kariya got the game winner, Bill, is going to be Jaguar.
Unbelievable. It absolutely is. The one thing that skews the hockey equation, and we talk about it all season long, you can outplay, outshoot, outchance, outhit, out everything, and you can still lose if you don't get the goaltending that's as good as the goaltending at the other end. Was Curtis Joseph bad? Absolutely not. This game was stolen by Jean-Sebastien Jaguar.
63 saves for Jaguar, three overtimes, outshot unmercifully by Detroit, and then the game winner.
And it was past his bedtime, too. I mean, the last 15 or 20 shots, it was truly past his bedtime. So he was just so cool in every aspect of the game, and this is what gave his guys a chance to get it done. Adam Oates on a faceoff, back to the point. Nicholas Havlid, just a terrific decision, and he made many of them all night long to get the puck to the front. But you saw the Mighty Ducks outnumber the Red Wings down low. I think the Red Wings were so used to just jumping out of their zone so quickly all night, they didn't drop down low enough to help out. And as a result, Curtis Joseph saw his guys get outnumbered in front, and Paul Kariya from that range can score on anybody.
Paul Kariya gets the goal. Havlid and Carney are given the assists on it. The great battle ended up being in net, not as anticipated, because when the game started, it looked as though Detroit was just going to run away with it. They dominated the first period in chances.
They did, and then it was a strange game, because in the second and third period, the Mighty Ducks truly stabilized, and it became their kind of game. It was a 1-1 game, which was their kind. Grinding, they denied time and space. Steve Ruchin did a magnificent job. Let's not forget about the job that Mike Babcock did in his attempt to negate Sergei Fedorov by playing Steve Ruchin ahead of him, and he stuck religiously to that matchup, even when it meant pulling a center off after only 2 seconds, and he did that about 40 times in the game to get Ruchin against Fedorov.
All right, Paul Kariya got the game-winning goal in the third overtime. Paul, I'm not going to ask you a specific question. Number one, congratulations, but tell me about this game from a guy on the ice.
Well, it was a tough game. It was a big-time battle out there. You know, they played very well at the start, and we started to get some momentum in the second period. And, you know, overtime was a struggle. They definitely outplayed us in overtime. Jiggy was unbelievable tonight. He made some huge saves out there, and we'll take the win.
So what was the mood in the locker room after the first overtime period? You guys were crushed in every aspect of that overtime period, except, of course, on the scoreboard because of Jean-Sebastien Jaguar. What did you guys say? Okay, we got him where we want him?
Well, we can't get any worse. You know, I mean, that was just horrendous out there. So it was nice to turn things around a little bit. But really, they had the play most of the overtime. And, you know, like I said, it was just nice to get the win out of it.
All right, Paul, congratulations on the overtime game winner.
Thanks, Gary.
There's Paul Kariya. He's the one who put it home. And here we go again. It has been a day and a first round of upsets. It's the Mighty Ducks.
Thank His hair's not even wet.
Yeah, well, he's a cool customer.
Man.
He's got to be in good shape.
Let's talk about faceoffs. Anaheim, of course, came into this series thinking that if, you know, we do well on faceoffs, it's one of the little things we can do well to help win. But Barry, Sergei Fedorov, 17 for 26. Darren McCarty, 9 of 10. Datsyuk, 15 of 24. They've dominated just about every part of the game.
Look, what Dave Lewis got to be telling this team, we won everything except the score. We dominated offense. We dominated defensively. Our special teams were good. Everything we wanted to do, we did. We ran into an unbelievable hot goaltender. If he can do that three more times, yeah, you got to give him credit. I don't think he can. I don't think anyone thinks he can play like that again. And that's what Dave Lewis is telling his team. And don't forget, this isn't foreign territory to the Detroit Red Wings before. They were down last year 2-0 going into Vancouver. So they'll regroup.
Yeah, they're obviously the much better team. I'm not sure what the Ducks can do for a full series ready to stop them. Keith Carney played 44 minutes, 19 seconds.
And he's got small hands.
It smells like cabbage, too.
And that's even worse.
Any kind of adjustments the two teams will make, or will you think that most of the games will look like this and feel like this?
Well, obviously, Detroit's going to want to get as many chances as they had tonight, and Anaheim's going to try and slow the pace as much as they can. Obviously, Mike Babcock worked hard to get Steve Ruchin against Fedorov. I don't know that we saw a great game from Sergei Fedorov tonight, but if Detroit's going to get that many chances night after night, they're so talented that they're going to win the games. I can't see that any way a goaltender can make 63 saves a night. Detroit played pretty well, as Barry mentioned. Their special teams were good. They moved the puck well. Just had no puck luck around the net. It's only one game, and if you look around the rest of the playoffs, there's a lot of top seeds that are down 1-0, in particular teams at home that are now in a 1-0 hole. So Detroit shouldn't feel too terrible about it. They're a veteran group. I'm sure they'll bounce back fine.
And you know what's important, too? Kudrow did not give up a soft goal. Yeah. Both goals were excellent goals, so it's not like he went in and lost the game for him. He made some key saves during that overtime. Not many, but some key ones.
And you mentioned Fedorov. Three shots on goal in the first period, none the rest of the game. With, you know, Yzerman not 100%, and he's the guy now that really, to win a championship, as the other guys get older, he has to have his A game.
He certainly does, and this is a guy, you know, if you don't look at just as a team, but as a as an individual, he's going to be an unrestricted, or he's going to be a restricted free agent at the end of the year. Fedorov has talked about, you know, he's rejected one contract from Detroit. This will come into play at various times. If he doesn't step up to the plate and become the guy in Detroit, you'll wonder where his future lies. But Fedorov has to do that. Yzerman is nowhere near the player that he has been in the past, and really nobody could expect him to be coming back from the surgery that he has had, Barry. He's really struggled and done pretty well with what he has.
Well, he had some chances to score tonight, and he's not there just for offense. He's there for a lot of other things in that dressing room, just to basically be the conscience of the team the way he's been the last few years. And I thought, actually, he played better than I thought he was going to play. I thought the grind line was unbelievable for Detroit tonight. Those are three guys that normally do the checking and run into guys. I thought each one of them could have had a couple goals.
All right, so the Ducks win game number one against the Detroit Red Wings on Paul Kariya's triple overtime goal. That's one major upset, and we are not done. This is the postseason of the upset so far. We know it's early, but the Minnesota Wild in Colorado against the Avalanche, who have been nearly perfect at home during the end of the regular season.
Some people don't realize how many nonstop flights Southwest offers, so we created this simple color-coded map to help. Baltimore to L.A. is red. Phoenix to Raleigh-Durham, blue. Chicago to Seattle, yellow. L.A. to Austin, canary yellow. Orlando to Albuquerque, teal. Las Vegas to Houston, aquamarine. Buffalo to Phoenix, beige umber. San Jose to Baltimore, pistachio. Oakland to Chicago, sea green. Albany to Orlando, puce. Tampa to St. Louis, pinkish. New Orleans to San Diego, kinda green.
You are now free to move about the country.
Hey, that thing got a hammy?
Yeah.
Sweet.
The all-new Dodge Ram Heavy Duty.
Did you mean the Charger? Because, you know, that's got a Hemi, too.
You're right.
Now with a 345-horsepower, 5.7-liter Hemi Magnum. Ram Heavy Duty. Enough muscle to grab Motor Trend's 2003 Truck of the Year award.
This guy tells his buddy there's nothing he'd like more than a new riding lawnmower. Nothing too expensive, he says, but nothing's going to give me any trouble. Nothing too complicated. Nothing better than making it look good and getting on with it. His buddy looks at him and says, nothing runs like a deer. Introducing the John Deere 100 series. Durability, precision, and exclusive support. For anyone who wants a tractor that's easy to run, easy to maintain, and easy to afford.
All right.
Some saves out there.
Guys, first period starts in 5.
To the end of our losing streak.
Seven shots from Milan Hayduk, 5 shots from Rob Blake, 5 shots from Joe Sakic. The Avalanche did what they wanted to do offensively against Dwayne Roloson. 41 shots in all. Outshot them 18-3 in the first period, but Roloson kept it close. He kept it tied. The Wild go on to win. After the game, Darren Pang. Steve Levy talked with the hero for the Wild, Dwayne Roloson.
Thanks very much. Back here in Colorado, and quite frankly, I didn't hear the 3-star selection, but I'm just going to go with the number one star of the
game.
Absolutely. For Minnesota was Dwayne Roloson, and he joins us now from just outside the Wild dressing room. But first of all, congratulations, Dwayne. Outstanding performance, obviously. What did it feel like? We always hear weathering the storm by the home team, first game of the playoffs, outshot 18-3 in the first period. What was it like for you and in the dressing room after the first?
Well, basically, we just, you know, we knew that it was going to be one of those games. We just had to go out and try and get into the game as quick as we possibly can and try to relax. You know, we got a lot of young guys that haven't ever played in the playoffs, and then we had a lot of veteran guys that haven't played in the playoffs in a long time. So, you know, everybody was pretty nervous, so we just wanted to try to go out and play the best we possibly can, you know, with the nerves, and then try to relax and come out you know, a little bit easier in the second and third.
Dwayne, we know how great that their big line of Forsberg is, and obviously they had some great chances. So I'll let you, maybe you can analyze some of the saves that you made. Some of them came from them. They seem to come from all directions, and I'll test your analytical skills right here.
All right.
Okay, because there was a flurry of activity here.
Yeah, Panger's worn out doing the analysis of your saves already, so.
Yeah, just basically on every one of these so far, I've just been trying to keep my eye on the puck and try and stay with it all the way through. And, they get in front all the time and just try, like I said, all the rebounds, just try and get over there, try and take away the things that I possibly can to eliminate them from getting it through.
Quickly, Dwayne, how much did you learn from playing with Dominik Hasek?
Well, I learned a lot. He's one of the best goalies that's ever played the game. Next to Patrick, those two are probably the best two that have ever played. And you know, it's anytime you can spend a couple of years and just play with him and play behind him. And I just try to not emulate him, but emulate his work ethic and the way he mentally gets ready for every game. And it's really helped me. And him and I've got a pretty good relationship. We've on and off the ice, we talked a lot there in Buffalo. And even last year when he's in Detroit, we got a chance to talk a few times. So it's great for me to be able to play with the guy and be able to keep in touch with him.
Dwayne, congratulations. We'll see you Saturday on ABC.
Great job.
Thanks a lot, guys. Have a good night.
It's Dwayne Rolison, clearly the star of the game. And I don't think we're going to see Manny Fernandez in that game two of the series. Guys, back to you.
Talked with Dwayne a couple weeks ago, and he says his first job was picking tomatoes. He was picking tomatoes all night long in Denver.
Yes, he was.
He also said his career turned around when he started working out, and that's something, Barry, I suggest for you. But I want to talk about Tony Granato first. His first playoff game as a head coach, it doesn't go well. How do you think he's taking it, first of all?
Well, thanks, Ashley Banfield. I think Tony's got to walk into that dressing room. He's got to be very confident, and he's got to let these guys know what has to happen. Number one, they dominated the playoff end, so they could have been 4-0 after the first period, and I think that's what he's got to sell. Look, at the goalie was great. Things didn't go well. We gave up a couple soft goals. Forget about that. We just come out and do the same thing again, and we'll score the goals this time. With the offensive talent, when Sack is getting chances, which we showed, when Forsberg's getting chances, which we showed, defense were getting chances, which we showed, those pucks will go into the net. The main thing he's got to sell is not to give up the first goal, because teams like New Jersey and Minnesota, with their system, they're twice a team with a lead than they are without the lead. So that's the main thing. Score the first goal, everything changes.
So again, the higher seeds off to a great start, 7-1 after 8 playoff series. We know it's early, just like a lot of opening day baseball teams kind of panic after a win or a loss in opening day. But the Colorado, how do you think they'll react in the next game? What do you do when you're down a goal to Minnesota? How do you adjust to this trapping defense they play?
Well, I don't think that there's much of an adjustment to make. I think the most dangerous thing you can do, really two things. Number one is start throwing the puck rink-wide across the ice, because they sit back in their trap and they want you to go from left all the way to right. Even if the pass gets completed, somebody's going to be there all by himself with the puck and he can't support it. Number two is you can't kind of play into the trap. You have to chip it down the wall, down the strong side where you have control of the puck, and get as much traffic to it as you possibly can. Look, the Avalanche had 18 shots in the first period. They should have been up, as Barry mentioned. Once they got down, what was really key is they kind of lost their focus for a little bit there. Skula made a mistake on the second goal. All of a sudden, it's in the net. It's 2-0. Quickly 3-0, and it's really difficult to get a lead back from Minnesota that far down. One thing they may want to watch is Minnesota likes to work the puck down low on their power play, and Colorado had all kinds of trouble this season with their penalty killers. Brunette's great from behind the goal line, stepping out and making the pass as he did to Kuba. That's probably the one adjustment that Colorado could make. But all in all, they played pretty well. They're just going to have to, much like Detroit, continue to get the puck at the front of the net, as many chances as you can. It's hard to believe Dwayne Rolison almost didn't start this game. They almost went with Manny Fernandez.
And as we all know, each successive win is harder and harder to achieve. Time for a timeout now. 20-second timeout, perhaps. Your emails. We love when you log on to ESPN.com and go to our email section and ask us questions. And you guys want to answer some emails? Fire them up. Take a quick timeout. More after this.
Wrong.
I don't know. It's just a little weird with them here.
They're just here because it's hockey night. They don't care about us.
Guys.
Guys. I need this. Come on, Schmookums.
Don't look at me like that.
We just finished riding. We'll go out tomorrow. I promise. Oh, all right.
The very eager, very stylish, very versatile Suzuki Katana. It's always looking for fun.
Hey, Prima Cop! Get off the ice! More like Prima Donna Cop!
Hey, does anybody know the Russian word for loser?
It's Prima Cop!
Ladies and gentlemen, visiting from Western Russia, the parents of right winger Alex Prima Cop.
Want to get away? Now you can. Fly Southwest Airlines with fun fares as low as $49 each way.
You are now free to move about the country.
Michelin designed the cross-terrain SUV tires specifically for SUVs to help provide responsive handling and a smooth ride. You'd be surprised just how smooth. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Back here with Ray Ferraro and Barry Melrose. I'm Ashley Banfield. Let's talk about the Islanders and Senators. Game 2, Saturday night on ESPN2. I want you to take a Peter Laviolette stance. Again, this is a team upset winning Game 1. How does he keep his team focused to do the same thing?
He's got to get the same intensity out of Yashin, which is very, very important. He's got to get the goals from the same guys because they've carried them all year long, guys like Skatchard and Blake. It was a perfect formula for the team, the way they did. But they got to get more goals out of Parrish. I think he's one guy that's got to start kicking it in.
For the Islanders and for Ottawa, really, they said they didn't come out with much intensity, which really baffles me. It's the first game of the playoffs. They need to wake up and play like they did during the regular season.
All right. Speaking of the Islanders, tonight's three salutes overtime cup winning goals on a very special anniversary. Do not miss this classic video next.
Tommy's party? I can't. I'm working.
The Dodge SXTs. Four cool cars. And you won't have to work two jobs just to buy one.
Done! You made it!
I like your hat.
Grab Dodge's 770 powertrain limited warranty. Ford, Chevy, and Toyota don't match it.
A guy in the corner, big producer. What's his name?
I don't know.
You sure it's not written there? Ooh, call my agent in New York.
Life's good when you're Eric McCormick.
Hey, it's me. I'm in LA. The producer we had that meeting with last week. What's his name?
It's Max Hoffman.
Max Hoffman. Thank you very much.
But life's better when you're Eric McCormick and you have the cell phone with a walkie-talkie. Coast-to-coast walkie-talkie service coming soon. Only from Nextel.
Why do I go to Pep Boys for service? Because they want to be champs. Last season, we went through an alternator, a radiator, and 32 air fresheners.
I don't have a lot of money,
so dealers are not an option, and not driving to tournaments isn't an option either. With Pep Boys, I get exactly what dealers offer for less.
Import or domestic, we'll help you get the most out of your car.
Our ASE certified technicians use the best parts and equipment.
Dealer quality service at prices you can afford.
Pep Boys, we're car people.
Tradition.
A look on the other guy's face.
To be my own Manning.
Being a woman.
Because last year, I couldn't.
Millions of little girls.
Every athlete is fueled by something.
NHL2Night. Brought to you by Bud Light, the proud sponsor of the NHL.
Tonight's three. June 10th, 1934, Harold Mush Marsh scores in second overtime.
Which
game
one's
five.
Mush?
Oh, this is, now we look at three other.
Oh, okay.
Winners. That's Uri Krupp, who won the cup for Colorado.
Mush Krupp.
Then 2000, Jason Arnott takes the feed, 8:20 into the second overtime. And the Devils win the Stanley Cup. They beat Ed Belfour and the Stars. And speaking of the Stars, Brett Hall, 1999, past Dominic Hasek.
That should have an asterisk beside it. That shouldn't have counted.
It counts, baby. Minnesota in overtime is the winner, 3-2. Freshman Thomas Venek, the hero, and New Hampshire beats Cornell. So your national championship game on ESPN Saturday will be Minnesota against New Hampshire. So again, what an amazing postseason. We're underway, and again, the underdogs are doing it. Any reason why? Is it just a fluky thing that they all happen to be winning?
It's parity in the NHL.
Okay.
There's not a big difference in the talent in the teams. The talent level certainly is different. And again, hockey's goaltending is a great equalizer. We saw that with Jaguar and Rolston. And again, effort overcomes talent. So you're seeing why a team can go. And home ice means nothing in hockey.
No,
that's the main
thing. I was just going to say that. Now, the buildings, when we played, they were certainly different on the road. The one example is in Dallas, Reunion Arena. I mean, you were scared to walk on the floor there. You'd stick to it. Now in American Airlines, it's nicer than your home rink, so it's a lot easier to play on the road. The rinks are all the same size now. You're not going to go into a Boston Garden or the Odd in Buffalo that was 15 feet shorter, or Chicago Stadium where you were scared to play. So it's a lot easier to play on the road, and I think that has something to do with it as well.
All right, so the Wild win, the Ducks win. Upset season continues. Don't forget, we are back every night here on ESPN2. We're on after Edmonton and Dallas here on ESPN2 for NHL Tonight. We will see you then. Paul Kariya, triple overtime hero. Cha-cha-cha.
NHL Tonight is a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.
Here in Las Vegas, the Excalibur Hotel has two knights squaring off in a joust. Well, the knights of the NHRA don their armor, and the battle is...